जब तक सरकार घुटने नहीं टेकती, उसकी कीमत कुछ भी हो।
अपने आदमियों को काम पे लौटाओ फौरन।
उन्हें मैं हुक्म नहीं दे सकता, वो तो अपने जमीर का कहा मानेंगे।
मार दो इसे, यही इनका सरदार है।
ये अभी अभी आए हैं सर।
क्या है सब?
टेलीग्राम है। बॉम्बे, कलकत्ता, मद्रास, दिल्ली, लंदन, केप टाउन, जोहान्सबर्ग, डर्बन, मैरिट्सबर्ग। और ये है पुलंदा, जमींदार और व्यापारियों का। ये एक है प्राइम मिनिस्टर मिस्टर चैम्बरलेन का। एक और है इंडियन नेशनल कांग्रेस प्रेसिडेंट सर फिरोज शाह मेहता का। और ये है वाइसरॉय का।
क्या कहते हैं?
संक्षेप में हमें खूनी कहा गया है एक तरफ से, और दूसरी तरफ से कि हम बर्बाद कर रहे हैं नटाल की इकोनॉमी।
वो गांधी, फोन करो प्राइम मिनिस्टर को, फौरन बुलानी होगी इमरजेंसी कैबिनेट मीटिंग।
यस सर।
गांधी भाई की
आइए गांधी भाई।
गांधी भाई, ये स्वागत कमेटी आपके लिए नहीं है, इसकी तो वजह रेलवे स्ट्राइक।
मैंने सुना है कि जोहान्सबर्ग स्टेशन को आग लगा दी गई।
रेलवे स्ट्राइक के नेता आपसे मिलना चाहते हैं, उन्हें आपके समर्थन की आशा है।
आप उनसे कहना कि हम उनका साथ तभी देंगे जब वो अहिंसा अपनाएंगे।
ना, ना, ना। गांधी भाई, इसके पति को गोली लगी है पुलिस।
बस नहीं नहीं, वो मत। ना ना, हम सब तुम्हारे साथ हैं। मुझे माफ कर दो क्योंकि दोष मेरा है। तुम्हारा पति हम सब के लिए जान देकर शहीद हो गया है? तुम्हारा दुख तभी दूर होगा जब और कई बहनें मेरी पत्नी समेत तुम्हारी तरह विधवा बन जाएंगी। आओ आओ, चलो मेरे साथ।
फिर मिलते हैं दो थके हारे जनरल।
उम्मीद है संधि करने के लिए।
संधि? तुम जब तलवार पकड़े हो सत्याग्रह की मेरी गर्दन पर।
तलवार नहीं, हिंसा नहीं, और कोई प्रतिशोध भी नहीं।
जानता हूं जानता हूं, तब तो निपटना आसान रहता अगर उन रेलवे स्ट्राइकरों की तरह तुम भी सीधे हिंसा का प्रयोग करते।
जानता हूं, इसलिए तो हमने सत्याग्रह अपनाया है।
तुमने मुझे बेबस लाचार कर दिया गांधी, क्या करूं मैं तुम्हारे साथ? तुम्हारे ऊपर हाथ उठाऊं तो खलनायक कहलाऊंगा। सुना है तुमने म्यूनिसिपल वर्कर्स वापस काम भी भेजे और रेलवे स्ट्राइक को भी समर्थन नहीं दिया क्योंकि उन्होंने तोड़फोड़ की थी। तो गांधी, तुम क्या चाहते हो?
सब कुछ हमारे खातों में है जनरल, कालनबाग के, पोला के, काचले के और मेरे।
तुम्हारे वफादार चेले?
चेले नहीं, साथी हैं जनरल।
कमीशन के पेपर सर।
तुमने दो नाम बदलने को कहा है कमीशन में, यह नहीं कर सकता, बाकी मुद्दे सामने रखे जाएंगे कमीशन के।
हमारी राय नहीं ली गई थी, इसलिए हम कमीशन के सामने नहीं आएंगे जनरल।
मुझे एतराज नहीं है, पर औरों को गवाही देने से नहीं रोका जाए।
उस 3 पाउंड टैक्स का क्या हुआ?
वो मनसूख किया जाएगा, ये सब आपको मिलेगा अंतिम ड्राफ्ट में।
और वो शादियों का मामला?
हम एक विवाही शादियों को मान्यता देंगे, चाहे किसी भी धर्म की हो। हिंदू और मुस्लिम परंपरा से रची शादियां कानूनी मानी जाएंगी। अब रह जाता है बस सवाल डोमिसाइल हिंदुस्तानियों के प्रवेश का ऑरेंज फ्री स्टेट और केप में। गवर्नमेंट को इस बात पे राजी किया जा सकता है।
तो यही मान लिया जाए कि ये आरसी समझौता है?
जो चाहे कह सकते हो,
लेकिन इस बार मुझे सब कुछ लिखित चाहिए जनरल, जबानी आश्वासन नहीं, कहीं बाद में आप बात पलट न दे।
मान गए, आपको लिखा हुआ बयान मिलेगा और स्पष्ट है आपकी राय ली जाएगी जब इंडियन रिलीफ एक्ट जारी होगा।
वैसे तो हमारे इस अभियान की सारी मांगें पूरी हो गई हैं, फिर भी हम रंग भेद के खिलाफ अपनी ये लड़ाई जारी रखेंगे।
और अगर मूल निवासी आपके उदाहरण की नकल करें?
वो अपना वतन जीत लेंगे।
आप मुझे और तंग करने वाले हैं?
मैं नहीं, मैं तो हिंदुस्तान लौट रहा हूं।
मुझे यकीन है कि हम आपके बारे में वहां से बहुत कुछ सुनेंगे। आप इजाजत दे तो कहना चाहूंगा कि ये कपड़े आपको सूट नहीं करते।
मैंने ये कपड़े पहने हैं और अपना सर मुंडा है उन सत्याग्रहियों के लिए जिन्होंने जान की कुर्बानी दी है।
ये क्या है? शुक्रिया।
ये सैंडल मैंने आपके लिए जेल में बनाए थे।
ये बड़े मजबूत हैं। आप तो जा रहे हैं, पर लगता है कि मैं आपके इन जूतों में बहुत दिन चलूंगा।
वो एक अजनबी देश आए और उसे अपना बना लिया। जब वो हिंदुस्तान के जहाज पे बैठे तो दिल में सुख के साथ दुख भी था। सुख इसलिए कि वतन लौट रहे थे कई वर्षों के बाद, और दुख इसलिए क्योंकि दक्षिण अफ्रीका से पिछड़ रहे थे, जहां जीवन के 21 साल गुजारे और जहां उन्हें अपने जीवन का लक्ष्य मिला।
मैं हमेशा एक दक्षिण अफ्रीकी हिंदुस्तानी रहूंगा। मैं ये सबक कैसे भूल सकता हूँ कि भयंकर द्वंद का भी शांतिमय समाधान हो सकता है, अगर नतीजा हम अपनी आत्मा के जरिए खोजें कि हम सब एक हैं, शांति और समन्वय ही हमारी इंसानियत की निशानी है।
I hope all of you like the film, a very important and a landmark film of all time. We are very fortunate to have the director of the film, the great Shyam Benegal ji, with us. It is not an easy, it is rather a rare and a lifetime opportunity to hear about this film from the director himself. And who else than Shri Shyam Benegal ji? Sir, we welcome you.
Good morning. Well, you know, there is a kind of background to this film. When the, you know, South Africa, the apartheid movement disappeared, and we recognized, that is, India recognized the anti, or rather the post-apartheid South Africa. And when we recognized the country at that time, it was felt by our government that we should make some kind of film, you know, film which would help in you know, getting our relationships much closer. Because one of the things was that we had a huge South African Indian population. Because, you know, over the, or almost a century, we had people going there as a, or being sent there as indentured labor. And that's how actually Mahatma Gandhi himself, when he went, he went there in order to find some kind of employment for himself. Because he went from Kathiawar, and when he went there, he found that the condition of the Indians there was dreadful. And that started him on his journey, which eventually made him into the father of our nation. And the one of the things was that it was the beginning of his consciousness. His political consciousness, his social consciousness, his understanding of relationship, human relationships, his understanding of, you know, racism, all these many ideas that worked. You know, I mean, all of this put together, now all that came and made sense to him when he went to South Africa. And when he went there, of course, when he joined as an apprentice in a law firm that belonged to somebody, a friend of his uncle or cousin or somebody, I can't recollect now. But the important thing was that when he went there, he was absolutely shattered when it hit him personally, when he was thrown out of a train, you know, because he had moved and he paid for a first-class ticket and went into the first-class cabin. But he was not allowed there. He was physically thrown out by the authorities, the rail authorities themselves. So that's, you know, when he suddenly realized the horror of the you know, the apartheid business, because, you know, that was the beginning of him, of his whole career, which eventually led him to become the greatest leader of our country, of our time as well. So, you know, this was a story that was waiting to be told. And when I was invited, to South Africa as soon as the apartheid disappeared. And when I went there, you know, they were thinking, the government of India and the new government of South Africa were thinking of making a co-production, a film, essentially about Nelson Mandela. But when I was offered that film, I said, but how can I make a film on Nelson Mandela? I don't know anything about him. And we accept that he is the father of the new nation of South Africa. But beyond that, it would be very, you know, ridiculous for me to think that I can make a good film about this great man. So I mentioned that both to our authorities as well as to the South African authorities. And I said, instead of that, why don't I make a film on young Gandhi? Because young Gandhi did two things. He became a political person when he was in South Africa, for one thing. And secondly, the means the weapon he used to get India, you know, to make India free was a weapon he, you know, he experimented with in South Africa, which was that of Satyagraha. And that was a very, very important thing to work out, because, you know, it's something that nowhere else in the world had happened, that you have a non-violent weapon. You know, you're working on the basic conscience, you know, of humanity, you know, and the ideal of humanitarian ideals on that basis. And that's how, you know, the whole story of Gandhi begins. So, and that happened in South Africa. And so that was the story I thought should be told, because very few people in India even knew at that time that young Gandhi had spent a lot of his time, many years as a matter of fact, over 20 years in South Africa. And so that was the thing that I wanted to do, because there was a film already made on Gandhi by Richard Attenborough, but there wasn't a film about Gandhi, you know, as a, no story about young Gandhi himself. And so at that time, we decided that we were going to do this film. And I went to South Africa for a recce trip. I met President Nelson Mandela. But one of the interesting things about when I met him to talk about this particular film, he spoke to me, he said, strangely, he said, you know, the person who really got me politically involved, who was the inspiration for me, was not so much Gandhi as much as Nehru. And that absolutely floored me, you know, because I never realized that even Nehru had such an incredible influence on the South African freedom movement. You know, so the ANC, of which Nelson Mandela was the leader, that itself, of course, had its origins in the NIC, which is the Natal Indian Congress, which was started by a group of people who were both South African, native South Africans, as well as the Indian settlers there. So it was altogether a fascinating story. And I think, you know, my two young protagonists, you know, Rajat Kapoor playing young Gandhi and Pallavi Joshi playing young Kasturba, were absolute genuine finds, because they gave a great performance. And I remember when we had the premiere in South Africa, both in Durban as well as in Johannesburg, you know, with the fact that Nelson Mandela was so pleased with their performances. So he invited us all for breakfast to his home in Johannesburg, you know, in Pretoria, which is the official capital of South Africa. Thank you.
Thank you so much for these wonderful opening remarks, Shyamji. Some really interesting stories also coming about. And I would just like to ask you, like, as a director, were you, I don't think it's a simple yes or no question, but were you satisfied with the end result that you had in what kind of other stories maybe you would have liked to show? Because, of course, the Mahatma has such a vast experience in those 20 years. Do you think there were some other stories you might have wanted to show which you weren't able to because of some limitations?
Well, I can't, I couldn't follow the question. Unfortunately, my setup here is so basic that I can't really hear you too well. Okay. So there's nothing I can do.
Repeat.
And
repeat the question.
Well, perhaps it might help if you repeated the question.
Yeah. Maybe Yashwanji could repeat the question. I think you could hear them a little clearer in the trial. Hello? Yashwanji, I think you are on mute. Yashwanji, you're on mute.
Hello. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sir, I'm repeating the question. The question is that it was Gandhi, even in Africa, is a huge subject, and it is very difficult for anybody to contain such a big thing in a cinema or a 2.5 hour thing. So, do you think there were more stories you would have liked? Have you had an option to tell more, or you are happy with whatever is there in that movie?
Well, I had chosen to tell the story of Gandhi in South Africa, no more. Because, you know, the moment he left South Africa and came to India, that's where the film Gandhi begins, actually. You know, the monumental work of Richard Attenborough, of Gandhi, actually begins, the real story of Gandhi begins when he comes to India. Because that's where he found it. And yeah, he became the father of our nation. You know, and the entire freedom movement, you know, he took over the reins of the freedom movement and he led the country to victory on the principle of satyagraha and non-violence, which he discovered for himself when he was in South Africa. So South Africa played a very important part, you know, in the whole business. So actually, India also, you know, as soon as apartheid was abolished and there was a popularly elected government in South Africa, the first country to recognize South Africa was India.
Thank you so much for that answer. I think it's a little unfortunate that Shyamji isn't able to hear me directly since I had the flow of questions with me. I will keep requesting Yashwantji to answer the question to Shyamji so that he can hear us clearly. Now, Yashwantji, the second thing I would just like to you to convey to Shyamji is the kind of resources, the literature that he would have had to go through, especially on Kasturba, because her life isn't that well documented. What kind of resources were he able to find? If you could ask him about it.
Sir, the question is that you might have gone through a lot of research and collection of scriptures, documents, books, and whatever. It is very understandable. But because there is not much of literature available on the character or details of Kasturba Gandhi. So, I mean, would you like to address that?
Well, you see, there's a lot of material. There's hardly any material on young Gandhi in India. There wasn't. Now, of course, the archives are absolutely marvelous because we have practically everything that we would like to know about him in India itself. But there was in South Africa, you know, in their archives, there was certain material that I couldn't possibly locate in India. And when I went to South Africa, when we were researching the film, we went to their archives and then found a whole load of material, which is very interesting, fascinating. You know, and that was something that became very an important source material for us, particularly relating to the sort of environment of South Africa at the time, which of course, sitting in Bombay, one wouldn't have known.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And anything about Kasturba Gandhi? I mean, what records could you find? Did you find enough references of Kasturba Gandhi for the movie, or you had to recreate a lot of things?
Well, there's a lot of written about in Gujarati, and Kasturba herself had spoken about it a great deal. And when they were, you know, because she was a woman in her own, I mean, extraordinarily independent-minded woman. And although she followed her husband all the time, but she was a very tough lady. She wasn't, she wasn't the kind of submissive wife. She was his strong right arm. And that was what made them such a powerful couple. You know, it was quite an extraordinary combination. While when he was there, she would be very quiet. But left to her own, she was absolutely, you know, she knew what her mind was, what she should do and so on and so forth. Because, you know, while Gandhi was out, you know, doing everything for the whole world. She was doing a great deal for the home, not just her own home, but for a whole lot of people. You know, so she was quite an extraordinary person. So I think some aspect of that we brought into our film. You know, because she contributed a great deal to begin making Gandhi the Mahatma that he became.
Yes, sir.
Yashwanji, the next question that we had in mind, which I would like you to convey to Shyamji, is about how, and it's very interesting that we come to know that this was also somewhat of a government initiative, but it never glorifies the Mahatma as a god. It shows very real human moments, his failures, maybe as a family man. And if you could just comment on how he took this decision of ensuring that these flaws also came to light in his movie, even though maybe might have been also a government initiative, so there might have been different factors at play. Still, the humanizing aspect of the movie of Gandhi, if you could just comment on that.
Sir, I'll repeat the question.
No.
I will repeat the question, sir. The question is that, you know, when you made a film about Gandhi in South Africa, although it was a very beautiful thing, nobody else other than you would have thought about such a niche where such great films like The Great Salt March or The Gandhi was already made. So in that thing, for an Indian, Gandhi is such a big image that is there. How could you keep him as a human? Normally, one would end when one wants to tell a story about somebody. Somebody would end making him a god or something like supernatural thing. But you have maintained the weaknesses also what a human would have, and very nicely treated and put him as a human only.
Well, that was the whole point of it. The whole point of making the film was to see him in a human dimension. You know, when he becomes a Mahatma, he sort of transcends everything, and you forget that he was a human being. And one of the things was that he had all the problems and foibles of most human beings have. What was the one weapon that he had that made him completely, transcend everything? Was his, you know, his kind of experiments with truth. He wrote his own autobiography, which he called My Experiments with Truth. Now, the fact is that he had made up his mind that he would be truthful, absolutely truthful to himself and to the world around him. You know, it's a kind of thing which is almost impossible for people to handle, you know, individually. But he had such an extraordinary capability, and you know, he was such a hugely capable person that he had the strength of will that perhaps nobody else among the public leaders that we know had and have even today. You know, I mean, there's nobody, because that was what made Gandhi the Mahatma, is enormous strength of will. You know, he had a strong will. He was absolutely bone honest, not with the whole world only, but with himself. You know, before he tried anything, you know, any one of his experiments with anybody else, before that he would do it. He was the laboratory where he would try it out on himself first.
I ask a question over here. So, the kind of studies what you have and the great amount of work you already had before making of this film, were you a follower or a believer in Gandhi before you made the film, or it was just a subject or even if you were a follower, was it because you appreciated Gandhi, or it was just an object the way you would have done any other film? I'm talking whether you had some special affinity for the character or for the story you were doing for the making of the Mahatma.
Well, I wouldn't call myself a Gandhian in the sense that most people consider Gandhians. You know, because it was like, you know, he is the father of our nation. So he's sort of, in some ways, above us, you know, in the sense that you don't see him as a human being. You see him as a transcendent being, and you sort of say that, you know, you consider him to be much more perfect than all of us. So naturally, the question does not even arise that you're looking at him as somebody you can follow. This was the big problem. Because, you know, although Gandhi himself was the kind of person who had all the foibles and the problems of other human beings. But, you know, when somebody says you're a Gandhian, it means that you have to follow the precepts of Gandhi, which are not always easy to follow. You know, he's a very difficult man to follow. So there are people who have been able to do that to a large extent, but it also calls, you know, for a kind of, you have to become, you know, you have to submerge your ego considerably to be able to function very much the way he would like you to function, or rather his principles dictate. Doesn't happen. I mean, we all have our egos. We all want to have our individualities and so on and so forth, you know. So it's not always easy. But there are many, many ideas of Gandhi that continue to be relevant, continue to be important in life. And one of the most important ones, of course, as you know, is nonviolence. And nonviolence, in the way he preached nonviolence, it may have been a little extreme, but even then, he was not the kind of person who would say nonviolent under all conditions, all circumstances. He may have said, you know, it's like Jesus Christ, you know, he would turn the other cheek if he was slapped on one, turn the other cheek. But this is much more than that. We are talking about somebody who would, of course, stand for humanity and the principles of humanity under any circumstance. Now, it's something that's not terribly easy to follow, but it certainly is a great ideal to have.
Sir, you have handled Gandhi later in Bharat Ek Khoj also. There was, you covered the next part of Gandhi in that movie, wherein you used a different actor. And although it has the limitation of a TV series, would you like to say something, the relation or no relation on as to how should we look at these two films coming from you on this more or less the same subject?
Who? You're talking about
Bharat Ek Khoj.
And the Gandhi came?
Yes, yes.
The episode called I and Gandhi came?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's based on a book. You know, which was a marvelous book, which was a novel written in the 1930s about a little village in Karnataka, actually. And that's what I did, because, you know, it was a question of him, not necessarily as an individual, as an idea. You know, when you say, and Gandhi came, you're talking about the idea that Gandhi... I mean, the ideas that Gandhi brought to the country, which eventually led to our freedom, and also led to the whole ethical framework on which our own constitution has been written.
Right. Sir, it was a great film, even watching Bharat Ek Khoj overall, not just the Gandhi part, but the whole thing for the later generation, the generation after the film, treat all these two works as the basic document. Like, suppose somebody who has not gone very deep into the history will treat Bharat Ek Khoj made by you, that the TV series, and making of the Mahatma as the basic document to get a brief understanding of things. Sir, I would like to ask another question. You have a history. You were the beginners of the new wave cinema, if you allow me to call it like that, and the movies like Ankur, Manthan, Mandi, and you introduced all new actors and actresses like Sadhu Meher K.M., Nasruddin Shah, Om Puri, Amrish Puri, Shabana Azmi, Smita Patil, everybody came through your films, and you did not continue with them for very long periods of time. Would you like to tell me as to were you keeping away from the stars or the stereotypical images of artists, or were there some other reasons for that? Always using new artists from NST and FTI and wherever.
Well, you see, the audiovisual media, the forms change so dramatically over a period of time. Cinema, as I knew it, no longer exists. You know, it's today all media sort of converge. One goes into another quite easily. And then the whole manner in which people watch films is also so different. It's no longer the way that it was an occasion. You bought tickets to the cinema, you went there, watched a thing in a darkened hall with so many other people around you. That kind of an experience of the cinema no longer exists. So that, you know, the cinema that created a kind of larger than life image, particularly of the kind of stories you told and stuff like that, all that has gone. Because today, much of our material we get is either on television or even on your cell phones. So you see the dimension that separated you from what you saw, that has disappeared. So you can't even, you know, it has had a tremendous kind of impact on the kind of material you now use to tell your stories. You know, you cannot make those epic type of things. If you're doing that, then you do it as a series, as a television series, not as a film. You know, so the whole experience of audiovisual media has changed over a period of time, as it must, you know, because with new technologies coming in, the whole experience, they offer you different aspects. So everything doesn't come from one source now. It comes from multiple sources. And all of us get our, you know, the audiovisual media communications from so many different sources, even for entertainment.
Asking about why.
Sir, here.
Yes,
sir. I would like to ask you another question here, which is about a little different film, but a beautiful phenomenon. It is about your film Manthan. Manthan is learned to be produced by the farmers of Gujarat. Probably it was a crowdfunding, what we call today, that day. And it also is a film in between a documentary and a feature film. Would you like to tell about that, how the 5 lakh farmers became the producer of a film, sir? And how the success when the truckloads of farmers started coming to the theater halls to see the movie?
Well, you see, I must give the credit largely to Dr. V. Kurian, you know, who was head of Amul at that time, and also later on became chairman of Gujarat Cooperative Milk Marketing Federation, and eventually from Delhi, the entire dairy industry is kind of a father of the Indian dairy industry. Now, he was, he was very keen to make a film about the Amul experience, about not the entire Gujarat experience, but Anand, you know, where the milk revolution actually began, where Amul is located. And he wanted to make a film about that experience. But what happened was that he actually thought that perhaps we should make a documentary. But we'd already made a couple of documentaries by that time. And so I thought, why not make a feature film? You know, to tell the experience, not so much as a documentary, but as a story, as something that people would get involved in. Not something that you're telling from the outside, but where they become part of it. Process. And and that can only be done with a feature film. But he said, well, you know, I can't get farmers to pay for something like that. So I said, well, let's see how you can do it. So he came up with the idea that since milk, you know, it was a cooperative, these were dairy cooperatives, he said he would send a message to each one of the people, dairy farmers, who supplied the milk to Amul, you know, twice a day, every day, that they should, if they would allow Amul not to pay them for one time, you know, whether in the morning or the evening, the money that they would get for the milk that they supplied. And they all eventually agreed. And having agreed, we put together that money and made the film. So, you know, so it was, in fact, in reality, it was produced by all those 500,000 farmers. And that's how we managed to make the film. And the odd part of it is, as you well know, as everybody knows, the fact is that the initial audience for the film were the same farmers, which meant that not only did they finance the film, they also made it viable once the film was made, and it started to run into profit already.
Thank you, sir.
Just like to say something here, and then Yashwanti is unable to hear. It's quite amazing, actually, how today, when even other filmmakers, say, for instance, maybe sometimes documentary filmmakers, are looking and struggling for funds, and this phenomenon is an amazing example of how one can go ahead with cinematography. And one other thing that I'm trying to make of Mahatma, similar to the issues of rights, is that about how Mahatma Gandhi also started as a labor rights activist in some sense, talking about the rights of the laborers, and especially the in which daily wage laborers are being. The person struggled so hard to make sure the issues were important. Would you like to say something about the present context? If Yashwanti could please convey this question.
Sir, I repeat the question. The question is that in the present context, that the labor issues that is going on, it also seems that Gandhiji was a labor activist. He had issues related to labor raised in South Africa also. Would you like to put these two things in perspective or the story as to whatever you prefer?
Of course, because, you know, I mean, Gandhi was concerned with a lot of things. He was concerned with all the problems relating to capital, labor, a lot. But his solution to the problem was not a confrontational one. It is, he always worked on the basis of consensual the solutions. So basically, you know, if you go by the Gandhian principles, then you must find a solution that is consensual, that is acceptable, largely acceptable, let us say, to both parties, both confronting parties. So, you know, the whole labor and capital relationship was based on that kind of consensuality, which means that you had to function. The idea was that you had to make it non-exploitative. That was the whole thinking as far as he was concerned. But the fact is that, you know, the world's not always that perfect. And although it is a perfect ideal even today, but there will always be the point to look forward to where you can solve problems through consensual means.
Yeah, and that is actually very important, I think, what you just said about what we must work towards, and that is really what Mahatma showed us. One other thing that I had in my mind was the kind of music that you might have had to use in the making of this film, especially because of the people it was appealing to and the people it was portraying. The struggles of these people you were portraying in the movie had to resonate with the kind of music that you use. The two had to go together. Could you please comment on that? Yashwanti.
Sir, the question is about the music of the making of the Mahatma. The question is that the movie is very sensitive. How could you make it that the movie, that the music somehow supports the storytelling rather than being something else? And also, in addition, I would also like to talk about your take on music in your films. You have mostly used one music director for a very long time, except one or two exceptions like A.R. Rahman and all. Would you like to tell about the music in your films and especially the making of the Mahatma?
Well, you see, music, as far as I'm concerned, music is part of a film. Whether you use it in the form of songs, whether you use it as background scores, but it has to be actually a part of film, like actors are part of a film, the story is part of the film, all this kind of thing. Music has to be integral. If there is no need for music, it cannot be integral, there's no point in using it. Now, as far as music use in making of the Mahatma is concerned, we had this score that worked out by Varad Bhatia. We recorded the music. In fact, the music was recorded by an orchestra in South Africa. You know, and some parts of it were done in Bombay, but some parts of it were done in South Africa. And then, of course, the last song of the film, which is really it's a kind of anthem. It was the ANC's song, you know, which was in one of the South African languages. And it was sung brilliantly by this girl whose name I've forgotten her, but she sang it so beautifully.
Sir, because now we are talking about music and craftsmanship of your movie, sir, I would like to bring another film here, Suraj Ka Satwa Ghoda. Why I'm bringing here is that the two actors of this movie have acted in that film also, Rajit Kapoor and Pallavi Joshi feature in that film. And the beauty of that movie is the time and space that is created. That the sense of time and space over the seven stories that happen in that movie. Sir, where does this concept of time and space, the way it is there in the movie, of course, it's a very delicate treatment. Would like to know whether it came from the original book by Dhanveer Bharti or it was a creation of you?
Well, you see, when the story was written, as you know, it was written, you know, when you write, it's very easy to go backwards and forwards. You can tell stories within stories, all these kinds of things. But film is unfortunately not a medium that allows you, you know, the words are different. When you write, you can do a lot of things because half of everything that is there, the meaning is given by you. You complement what you have read with your own imagination and your understanding of it. But when it comes to film, you see, it's already concretized. So there is when you shoot somebody, if a person photographs somebody, that person is already there. When you say sunset, you can actually see a sunset. But when you use the word, it was a beautiful sunset, each one of us has a different way, you know, to see a different sunset. That kind of thing. So the fact is that Suraj Ka Satwa Ghoda was a series of stories, cyclical stories, one within the other, and so on and so forth. So to find some kind of an ability to get the subjectivities out, you know, to understand the subjectivities, that was the attempt. I don't know whether it be succeeded or not, but it worked itself out well at that time. And certainly the people who saw it, many of them were not as confused, I thought, that they would become by seeing the film. But they did. I mean, the film actually worked quite well because of clearly, it had a fairly good run when it was released, and then, of course, it went on television several times.
So coming back to the making of the Mahatma, you have done, you have a huge body of work wherein you have done documentaries, ad films, these kind of things, and feature films and TV series and everything possible. You have done a lot of biographical films. The making of the Mahatma Gandhi is also one of them. You have done two movies on Nehru also. Would you like to tell me that what makes you turn towards so many biographical stories, biopics, what we call it?
Well, you know, it's very fascinating to make a biographical film. You know, you want to get into that person, because, you know, you make biographical films about people. In many cases, people whose work you have admired, or who, as human beings, you have admired or you consider have done a great deal to the society around them, or to the future of their country or whatever, you know. I mean,
what kind of impact do you think it has had on younger people, even now, when we try to see this film for lots and lots of students across the country? And what is the kind of message that you hope is getting across to these students this week?
Yeah, I mean, it is an inquiry saying that what message, as because we keep showing these movies to many young people, even at present, what message would you like to go through, or what message you'd like to share with them?
Well, you know, I mean, it's already there in the film. I mean, it's nothing that I don't have to invent any message. The fact is that when it comes to Gandhi, his message lives forever. It continues to be there. So it's just simply kind of bringing back into the forefront. You know, when you make a film about somebody like Gandhi, if you just bring the ideas back into the forefront, which we keep somewhere in the back of our mind, although it's very much part of our experience. You know, so I think there's nothing that we, there's no new ideas that I'm projecting. It is those ideas which are perennial, because even Gandhi's ideas were there before Gandhi. But he put them, he crystallized those ideas in a context. I think that's what we should learn. Because, you know, our thing is we have to look at it in our own individual context. And that's what the eventual learning is all about.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Shyamji. I think it's 8 on my clock and we have another session at 12, so we'll have to end here. Yasvinji, I would like you to formally thank sir, and then we will move to the next session.
Sir, it is a matter of great honor and pleasure to be talking to the greatest filmmaker of our times. We are really happy and we are really thankful for the support you have always extended to Speak Mike. We are thankful for the films you have made, and we are thankful for the talk you gave. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Namaste once again, everyone. I hope you're all there with us. Yes. I'll just request Yashwanji to say just two lines informally before I give a short introduction. Then we start talking about this that we just saw with these lovely portrayals by both of you. Yashwanji?
Sir, it is a great pleasure to have the lead actor and actress of the great film called The Making of the Mahatma, directed by Shyam Benegalji. It is a pleasure, and I am sure it's going to benefit a lot to everybody who is watching. They have just now watched the film, heard Shyam Benegalji, and now it's going to be a wonderful time with you. I welcome both of you, sir.
Thank you. It's lovely being here.
Thank you.
I'll go ahead with the formal introduction. First with Rajat Kapoorji. Rajat Kapoor is a multi-award-winning Indian actor, recognized for his extensive work in film, television and on stage. He's also an active stage producer and director. His meteoric rise to fame came with the popular television detective show Vyomkesh Bakshi, directed by Basu Chatterjee. Shortly after, his silver screen debut was in Suraj Ka Saath Ka Ghoda in 1992. directed by the master Indian filmmaker Shyam Bessel, which won the Best Feature Film in Hindi at 1993 National Film Awards. Of course, he's also been in the wonderful movie that we just saw, The Making of the Mahatma, again directed by Shyam Benegal ji. I'll not go into a longer introduction because we just saw your wonderful work and that speaks in volumes for itself. And just a little bit formally about Pallavi ji too. In case you're wondering why it's Manan on the bottom left corner, it's just a small technical problem on our side, and that's it. So Pallavi Joshi, he started her career as a child artist in the early 70s and has acted in 50 odd films and over 90 serials until now. As a child actor, her performance in the film Khamma Mara Veera was critically appreciated, and she also won the Best Child Actor State Award from the Gujarat government. Then, having acted in many, many popular films like Andhayur against Urichka Sathwa Goda and, of course, the wonderful Making of the Mahatma, the amazingly inspiring work that we just saw, she went on to win the National Awards Jury Special for a performance in Mohit Chokri also in 1995. Just a very short introduction, I would like to begin talking to you about the wonderful work that we just saw. So the first question, and both of you can answer the question that I'll go ahead with, was you were just like, this cinema is one that you did really early. You to recount in whatever you would like to share with the younger people watching about your experience in portraying these roles. Maybe Pallavi, would you like to go first and say how you felt when you got the role, how you felt portraying it, any other general remarks that you would like to make?
Yeah, it was kind of, you know, mixed. I had mixed emotions when I was first approached for the role. A, of course, I was extremely happy that I was going to play Kasturba Gandhi. With that came a little bit of fear, anxiety, because Rohini Hattangadi had done the, you know, character so wonderfully in Attenborough's Gandhi. And even before I read the script, my first reaction was, oh my God, how do I, you know, fill those shoes now? But it was only later when I actually went and met Mr. Benegal that he told me that the study of the physics, which, you know, it's his journey to becoming a Mahatma, and it's essentially about the earlier days. That's when I kind of started feeling a little settled. But yes, you know, playing a historical character, which is not, you know, a very, you know, an old page in the history, something that maybe some people have experienced. They were like Gandhians, and they used to follow the Mahatma. They have both been freedom fighters, and they had gone to jail. So it was like a huge responsibility to portray a character which is from such a recent history. Am I audible? Is there any problem with the audio?
I can hear you, but seems to be some disturbance in either your or Rajatji's mic.
Rajatji,
could you maybe try muting yourself while Pallavi ji is speaking? Maybe we'll be able to figure it out then. Hello, Rajatji, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
So the disturbance seems to have gone right now.
Okay.
So we just continue, Pallavi ji.
Yeah. And also, you know, it was the first experience of my life to, you know, work with an international unit. There were just a handful of us from India on the sets, while the rest were all South African cast and crew. So, in general, it was a very, very nice experience. And if I can recount one little episode that happened when we started shooting, there was some problem with the scheduling as we, you know, started rolling the film. In about a week's time, the entire shooting came to a standstill. And there's that disturbance again, right?
Something keeps coming. I don't know. Wasn't there in the tech check? it's okay. I think it's still, we can see here.
I'll continue if I'm audible.
Yeah.
So the entire shooting came to a standstill after about a week or 10 days of shooting, you know. And we took about a week to sort things out. Until then, we were all just sitting there, you know, enjoying the vacation. and the whole thing was, the whole shooting was like replanned, and the dates were reworked again, the whole film was rescheduled. And it was at that point that I realized that my work was only going to be in the last, you know, whatever, 15 days. And I was like, what do I do sitting in South Africa for 2 months without doing anything? So I was like, send me back. But we were all insured, and I couldn't leave the country. There was another actor with us called Keith Stevenson. So Keith and I, while Rajit was busy shooting, Keith and I, we were, you know, we traveled the length and breadth of South Africa. We went to Sun City, we went to Durban, we were trying out every single, you know, South African wine. And we were cooking every evening, and we were all meeting in, you know, somebody's room. Rajit had this wonderful recipe of papaya soup, which we were all of us one night. So while, you know, the shooting was on, and we were all involved in the shoot, and we're very serious about our work, there was a lot of, I still remember the good times that we had in those 2 months shooting in South Africa. And it was never before and a never after kind of an experience.
Wow. Yeah, like sometimes I think when we watch this amazing work come, we also forget about the experiences you would have outside the screen and how important they might be as well. So Rajitji,
they play a more important part because they kind of relax you. They bring the actors closer together, and you know, you form your chemistry outside of the camera also, which really helps you doing your scenes together.
No doubt. Rajitji, along the same lines, if you could tell us how you felt when you got the role, what you went through while portraying this.
Well, firstly, I wasn't meant to be playing the title role. I was playing Kachalya, who's a revolutionary. But actually, it was a makeup test for the lead. And there were a lot of actors. Still, I didn't give it much thought until 3 days after these makeup tests, I get another call from Mr. Benegal saying, hey, Cham, you're going to be playing the Mahatma. So, mujhe to aisa laga ki paon tale zameen nikal gayi ho. I didn't believe it. He says, aake kal mujhe milo. I went and I met him, and he gave me this book, My Experiments with Truth. And he says, this is what I want. And I was traveling, and I think that was somewhere in the first week of March. And I said, sir, when are we going to shoot? And he said, first week of June. So that really gave me very little time to prepare, particularly for a role like this. But again, my guiding force, other than Mr. Benegal himself, was My Experiments with Truth. And the first 20 years that Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi spent in South Africa, we were portraying that. So, unka jo manmutav tha, jo antardwan tha, jo kashmakash tha, wo is book mein badi sadgi se bayan kiya jata hai. And that's what he wanted. Of course, the physicality we had to work out. My ears were propped up with wax behind my ears. This deep cleft that I have was covered with wax. They tried to put wax in my nose, but it was very uncomfortable. So we said, forget it. But the director was clear that we will try our best to make you look closer to Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, because in no way do I look like Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. But the important point was to portray what was inside of him. That became a challenge for me. कह रहे थे ओ हो एक और आ गया गांधी बनने के लिए ना वन मोर एंड देन व्हेन यू आर पोर्ट्रेइंग सच अ फिगर दैट इज ग्लोबली नोन देन यू डू फील अ सेंस ऑफ रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी एंड दैट डिड बॉदर मी आई वुड जॉब एंड सी हाउ आई कैन डू दिस टू द बेस्ट ऑफ माय एबिलिटी आई नेवर हैड नेवर बीन अवे फ्रॉम होम फॉर 2.5 months. That's how long we were there at one stretch in South Africa. And as Pallavi pointed out, gradually everybody around you, their unit, our few actors were with us, you know, Keith, Ashok Mehta, the cameraman, Mrs. Neera Benegal, they all became family. And the bond that we formed then, so many years ago, to some extent between all of us, still exists today. And that's the beauty. We can just pick up from where things were left. because of that time we spent there. We came together, the teamwork, you know. It took a while, as Pallavi said, for us to get to know each other. You know, once we did get to know each other, then there was no looking back. And after that first week, I think things sort of worked far more smoothly, because we had a tough call. We had an average of 6 scenes to shoot in a day. And at times, Pallavi and me had just 2 takes to give it and to sort it out. So there was that kind of pressure, but we had such a wonderful unit. And the way I was looked after, you know, it was winter and I had everything I needed. Sometimes I would be on the sets at 4 in the morning because my makeup would take time and it would be freezing. And I know that we had such a good production that that heater would be running for me before I entered, even at 4 o'clock, ready so that I could start work on my makeup and be comfortable. So the comfort that we were provided, in spite of the long hours we worked, really made it worthwhile. So many actors who were there with us from South Africa, who played maybe not the lead, since Pallavi and me were there and Keith was there, but the way they came forward to help us and be part of the unit, it never for a moment felt as well in South Africa. After the film was shot and completed, if I remember correctly, Pallavi flew back to India and then came back for 2-3 days for dubbing. I stayed on. I went to the Cape of Good Hope for 3 days while they sorted the reels and assembled everything together. So everything happened all together so cohesively that it's an unforgettable experience.
Yeah, I think you left. The last words you said are exactly what
Sorry,
I wanted.
Can't to hear you.
You can't hear me anymore. Hello. Okay. Yashwanji,
can't hear Anish.
Yashwanji, could you?
I can hear you.
Hi.
Okay. You can't hear me. You can hear Pallavi ji. Hello.
Hi. Can you hear me, Rajat?
Yeah, but everybody's volume is.
Yeah, Rajatji, I think you got a phone call. So your audio will now be coming from your phone, the earpiece near your camera. What you might have to do is just call quickly and rejoin again, so that you'll be able to hear the cloud. You can? Okay. So I was just about to say that the last word you, and then you've spoken about it, and especially at Sigmeke, we try to invite you so often to talk about this one particular film. So I personally feel there has to be something about it that allows you to give us this positive, inspirational takeaway from whatever they do feel inspired after listening to you talking about the portrayals of your role. So what is it maybe about this movie that even after so many years you're able to talk about it so effortlessly and you're able to tell us these experiences? It might be different from the other works, if at all that is something you're doing.
You know, A, because of having gone through that book and studied what Mr. Benegal wanted from this character, there was so much I understood about Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi's thinking, the way his mind was working. So it was a great inspiration to begin with. And there are so many things that I still reassure myself with, whether it's to do with naturopathy, whether it's to do with just basic honesty, whether it's to do with your grit and determination. So on a subconscious level, portraying that character meant a lot to me personally, because there's so much I took away, which has become part of my life today as a human being, to stand up for, you know, what is right. So on a basic level, there are so many things that are part of me today. I mean, directly, I can say yes, maybe after portraying that character, I even became more stubborn, but stubborn in my beliefs in a very positive way, not in a negative way, you know. Just to understand the approach of, let's say, a thought like nonviolence. You know that things can be done without being violent, but having played...
Pallavi ji, Rajat ji, of course, refers a lot to the my experiments with truth, And having gone through that, I know what an honest account it is of the Maharaj's life. He doesn't try to, he shows that he might have made U-turns on some go through to come into this role of Kasturba. While Rajatji was, like, of course, went through the book. What access do you have to other resources to really get into this character?
Well, I also did go through my experiments with the truth, but in all honesty, I did not finish the book. I skimmed through, you know, a few pages because I think I was still a lot younger and, you know, I probably didn't have the seriousness of sitting down and actually reading the whole book. I thought, mujhe pata chal gaya hai, jitna pata chal gaya. But my two biggest, you know, points of reference were A, Mr. Benegal, and B, Fatima Mir. And I would sit down and just, you know, keep asking them questions. And I remember having this conversation with Mr. Benegal also. And I said, to begin with, you know, of course, Gandhiji being the father of the nation and everything. But it was only when I went through the book that I realized there's so much more to Gandhiji than what we've learned through our history books in schools and colleges, you know. So when I started having discussions with Mr. Benegal, and this was pre-reading, I would sit down, I would continue to sit down with him for some time and then keep asking him questions. So I remember asking him at one point that, you know, in all fairness, you know, the amount of good work that Gandhiji has done throughout his life, and yes, the whole country recognizes him as the father of the nation, but he did a lot of wrongs, you know, where his family was concerned. He was completely unfair to them. So why did he do this? Didn't he understand what his wife was going through or what his elder son, Harilal, was going through? So Mr. Benegal just turned around and said, well, you know, if he would have been correct in everything, he would have been God. But he's just a human being at the end of the day. And as Mr. Benegal said earlier in his talk, that is the aspect which we had to actually bring out. So I agree with Rajat that there was a tremendous takeaway because, you know, even now with the in the times of social media, people think that celebrities are gods, you know, that they can do no wrong, especially when they start following you and worshiping you. Yeah. And it's only, you know, one day that you say something wrong or you, you know, retweet something or you post something on your Facebook and the whole, you know, the world collapses and everyone like brings out your past tweets and say, oh, but this is what you had said in the beginning and how did you change? So, you know, at this point in time, I would just like to, make this very clear that if we're talking about celebrity, we're talking about politicians, we're talking about whoever it may be that you idolize, at the end of the day, they're all human beings. Yeah. And we all make mistakes. You know, so we have to give that, we have to consider that about the Mahatma also. He was a human being. And for all the good that he did to the country and to the freedom movement, he did some things wrong. And that's all right, you know. So that was a big takeaway for me. And I, once you start accepting your heroes as human beings, is the time that you realize that they're no different from you and that they can err, and to err is human. So that was a huge, huge takeaway for me.
I think that is very, very well put. And like you said, you were very young when you portrayed these really mature roles. And would you like to say something about the expectations that Shyamji had? Because, of course, now when we view the work, it is amazingly inspiring. But then when you're having to bring that out, as younger people and reconciling that with these amazing roles that you had to play, how was it for you? How was it?
See, right from the beginning, this was not the first project that I did with Mr. Benegal. I had been working with him for almost about 8-9 years before I did Mahatma with him. Yeah. Mr. Benegal has this, tremendous ability to put his trust in his actors. Once he's cast you for the role and once he's explained to you what he wants from you, then he doesn't meddle with anyone's performances. I've never seen Mr. Benegal coming up to us and saying that, like, no, you do it this way. Or, you know, नहीं थोड़ा ज्यादा हो रहा है या थोड़ा कम हो रहा है. He trusts you. You, this is your job. As an actor, it's your job to convey these emotions and you do this to the best of your ability. My job is to direct. So that's a tremendous quality about him, you know. But when we were doing this film, because this is such an important film and because the characters are like so heavy for us, I kept looking at him after every take, you know. Theek hua? Was it okay? Was it good? And he normally just says cut and moves on to the next shot. And here I, every time I went up to him, said, Shyam uncle, was it okay? Was it all right? Should we do one more? And so finally one day he was like, young lady, you are doing a good job. Okay, stop asking me these questions. If I find something wrong, I'll ask for a retake. So that's how he is.
Yeah. Rajit ji, first of all, my next question will be to you. You are on mute right now. You'll have to unmute yourself. Like she said, the comment of Shyamji about you doing a good job. There was someone else who we just mentioned in the previous session who might have agreed with him. And at the cost of meeting a lot of praise, he mentioned that even Nelson Mandela, Mandiba, watched the movie and he was very pleased with the portrayal. And he invited you all to meet him. And I'm assuming he would have asked you about the film too. So if you would like to tell us that story, because the younger people who, I don't know how much they know of Mandiba, maybe you could tell us something about meeting him and if you spoke about Gandhi to him and how that experience was.
You know, that was an other unforgettable experience. And, you know, Mr. Benegal himself is the epitome of humility. And here we had the chance to meet another human being who is also humility personified. Firstly, he was at the gate to meet us, the delegation of 10. You know, have you seen a president or prime minister coming to the road near the gate to receive you as your car drives in? No, I haven't. Then you go into the room and here this man himself was moving the chairs around, counting how many of us were there, so we need the chairs to sit in a semicircle. This is the man. And I still have that photograph. The ironical thing is, just yesterday somebody sent me that photograph. I don't know, it found its way into the archives where we are standing there being greeted. Yeah, being greeted. I put it up in my office, being greeted by the Nelson Mandela himself. So there you are. We learn from these people what humility means to us today.
And Pallavi ji, anything to add on this experience from your end? Because meeting Mandiba, something I would like to know, and maybe others who know, he's an inspirational figure in himself. You got to meet him through your work on Kasturba and Gandhi. So anything you would like to share?
Oh, that was perhaps, you know, the greatest high point of my life. I mean, to meet somebody who has, here we are making a film on Gandhi, who's the greatest man of the first half of the last century. And then we are sitting in audience with a man, the greatest man of the second half of the last century. I mean, what could be a bigger, you know, a moment for us? And I remember after the photographs were done, he was obliging us with a few, one-on-one pictures. And I wanted to ask him, you know, sir, can I please have one picture with you? But by the time I did this film, I had done a lot of television and I was famous in my own way. So I knew how, you know, the fans normally kind of swarm you and they ask you for your autographs and pictures and stuff like that. And I really didn't want to do that to Nelson Mandela, but I couldn't even contain myself. I couldn't stop myself. I couldn't, you know, get myself to speak up. And at that point, Rajat understood what I was going through. And Rajat had his, the copy of my experiments with the truth. And he went up to Mr. Mandela and he said, sir, I want you to sign this book for me. This is Gandhiji's autobiography. And as he was signing the book, Rajat just kind of, you know, he just called me in the picture. And there I was standing with the two of them. So there is one picture with me, Rajat, and Nelson Mandela. You know, there's the three of us. And I have that picture even now. I treasure it and I'm going to keep treasuring it all my life.
This is, I think it speaks about the about the movie in itself, a person like appreciating and calling you because like on the basis of that work. But also let's also talk about some very specific, very touching scenes in the movie, and I would like to know what you felt while portraying those scenes. Maybe first I'll start with you Pallaviji, and then Dajiji on the same scene of when Gandhiji tries to take Kasturba out of the house. I think that's a very powerful, very humanizing scene. And of course, the way we understand it and what it portrays to us versus what you went through while trying to convey that emotion to us. Could you tell us?
Well, I think that is a very, a very important scene, because it not just shows the relationship between the two of them, between the husband and wife. It also shows us the times that, they lived in. It also shows us the family system that existed during that time. So even in a fit of anger, when Gandhi was, he pulled his pregnant wife by her hand, and as he was trying to throw her out of the house, she turned around and said, "What are you doing? I mean, don't you even have the sense to realize that the neighbors might be watching us? And that's, just behave yourself. You can say whatever you want to say to me inside the house. You can't be making a scene outside." And as they went in, Gandhi realized what he had done. And so he said, "Okay, I'll clean that chamber pot." And she said, "No, I'll do it for you." But I just wanted to bring it to your notice that if you expect me to do all the work, you should expect, the people who call themselves your followers, they should also clean after themselves. So that was such a beautiful scene that it just, maybe in today's time, if a husband tries to do that, the wife is just going to say, "To hell with it, I'm going to leave your house. Or you get out," whatever. But in those times, in spite of the husband misbehaving, the wife still holds on to the home, holds on to the family, and says these things can happen indoors, not outside of the house.
And yeah, I think...
I mean, what can be more, how do you say it? A better example of the family system that we have in India.
Also, this scene is a classic example of be the change that you want to see. He would experiment with him and his family first. That's why they suffered. Yeah. So there is a humanistic aspect to it. At the same time, he's testing everything himself, with himself, his wife, his children, his family, and then allowing that thought or that action to be passed on to the rest of the community. To first make sure what it feels like to do it yourself.
And I think just one thing on this answer, about the change that we are trying to bring out in this conversation, about how Kasturba reconciled her role as someone who also has to take care of something, and the role of a family, and the role of supporting Mahatma in his endeavors, if I'm not understanding wrong. Pallaviji?
No, of course, we are, we all evolved from that time, and we are living in better times now. So, but what we learn from that incident is how she still held on to the family, and not let this one incident, break the relation between the husband and wife. So that is something that we learn from that incident. We also learn that she understood, as Rajit said, when he started the experiments with himself and with his family. In today's times, it might just do it. But in those times, the man was like the head of the household back then. So his wife, his children, they were all, in it with him. So that is the thing that we can learn in today's time, to hold on to the family, to keep the family together. But at the same time, I think Gandhi's action to the way Kasturba reacted, today's woman will probably react differently.
Yeah. Rajitji.
Rajit, we can't hear you.
Right now. Rajitji, you're on mute. Rajitji, can you hear me? You've been
now. Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Actually, there was some echo from your end.
To a certain extent, his family, to a certain extent, for the larger good. That's what he was doing, if you literally put it that way.
One other scene that comes to mind is the portrayal of them forming the medical corps, because the corps are especially working for the British army, but then they also ensured that they went ahead and served the Boers. And that was when the Boers were a community that were really ostracized in those times. And my team will ensure that they also get medical aid. So these are kind of, if you could just say something about portraying.
Also, Anish, regarding the medical corps, again, it's an example of being an example, because there were very few people coming to tend to the sick and the wounded. So he decided literally that, let me go forth. Maybe I will set an example. If I go and help myself, more people will follow and come after me.
Right. Definitely. And you're very right in saying that him apart from any other leaders. And I would just like to ask you, Rajiv, he's also a leader who maybe asked of his countrymen much more than any other leader. Like, he asked them to go right to the, when it was about non-violence or any other ideas, they were really stringent in the demands, what it demanded of the countrymen.
I think by setting an example, it gives you the confidence to then ask other people to question their belief or their action. When he was trying things out himself, if I do it myself, I know ki main kitne gehre pani mein hu. Then with confidence, I can tell somebody that I'm here to hold your hand. Come on, get into the water with me. And you'll know what it feels like. I'm standing in that water. There's also another aspect that I should have added. When you're portraying a character like Gandhi or an important lead role like this, your comfort level with your team and particularly your colleagues and your co-stars is so important. And firstly, I would like to state on this platform that I am very fortunate that in my first film, I had three most fantastic women performers opposite me, and they are the best in the country. And so I already had a great comfort level with Pallavi when we joined our hands together. And that also makes a world of a difference. When you have a comfort level with your colleague, with your co-actor, it enhances your performance. It makes a lot of difference.
I agree with that.
No doubt, because like you were discussing before, I see this emphasis on the gratitude that you have to the people who helped you in getting this role, in doing this role. Like Rajitji said in the very beginning, at 4 a.m., someone would have the heater on. And you went to another country to shoot this movie. And of course, you were getting exposure gradually, because it was just in the initial stages. So would you like to say something, Pallavi, about that aspect of being, like you mentioned, you were 22 and you wanted to come back. But you have, I would like to say that you have done it. And any possible?
No challenges, actually, besides that one. As Rajit said, all our vanity vans used to be preheated for us. And the makeup used to be laid out on the tables even before we would reach our vanity vans. And every now and then, I remember we had, become like one family. So every now and then we kept having parties, and there was
Well, that maybe the last day, the wrap party, because
was
I had
rap,
gone
was it the
I had
party?
Gone totally I had gone totally vegetarian, and I had so much fish on the last day that I had a stomach upset.
I think it was a wrap party. But then every now
we went to Kruger National Park.
We went to the house that we went to, a very, very beautiful house that Sunita's friend or assistant used, was it? Or
yes, I was there.
Yeah. And we were continuously invited out by people, and they made us feel so comfortable. And my entire stay was so wonderful there. Love the country. Because
I was so tempted. Right.
You're frozen, Rajiv.
I can't hear you. No.
Yeah,
I think, we didn't get that.
If you could just say the last part again. I think
because we were on insurance contracts. I was dying to drive while I was in South Africa, but I was given instructions. I can't drive if something happened to you, then we'll get stuck.
I think these experiences are equally important because we have to remember what goes into getting you to do these roles. And I would request Yashwinji also right now, if he has any questions on his mind which you would like to ask.
With Shyam Benegal, there were not many actors who did more than a film for him. He had all the time a flow of great actors coming in who later on made more than one of his projects. Would you like to tell me one after another, both of you, as to what you feel, what was that or how did it go?
No, I think, the list of people who just worked with him once is far, far smaller than the list of the actors who have worked with him a lot. He's repeated Shabana Azmi in his films, Smita Patil, Naseer, Danshish Patel, Ila Arun. So these are all the examples of people who have done a lot of projects with him. Similarly, I didn't get a chance to work with him again or something of the sort, but I think the list of the actors that he's worked with in more than one project is far longer than the actors who've just done a one-time appearance in his films.
I think I've been very fortunate because since my first film, Suraj Ka Saath Baar Ghoda, with him, I have been part of all his projects, all 13, 14 of them since then. There was one instance where I nearly missed it with Welcome to Sajjanpur. But he actually called me and he says, there's nothing exciting for you. There's just one scene for a clerk who comes in and goes out and I can give it to anybody to do it. And I said, nothing doing. I'm flying out to Hyderabad. You tell me which day and I'm going to do it. Now, after so many years, actually, if he doesn't give me a role, I'll be upset. I told him, if you want me to play a tree or a branch hanging from somewhere, I'll come and I'll stand there. Now you can't do that. It's become, and with that trust and respect you build up, it's like family now. Now I genuinely, I will get upset if he doesn't cast.
It did happen with me, when Sardari Begum was earlier planned with Shabana. Shabana ji had some date problems and then Kiran, he said that, I won't be able to cast you because you don't look like Kiran Khil. And I was so unhappy and I was so miserable. I said, no, you do anything, we'll do makeup trials. I'll look like Kiran Khil, but I can't be out of your project. But then unfortunately I couldn't do it because, he had a different thing in mind. But then he called me back to dub for one of the characters and I did that.
Oh,
still
that's
part of the
nice
film.
And
yeah, I still became
it,
a part
it is very understandable. It is very, very understandable how cherished a name like Shyam Benegal is that. And I'm really surprised to know that Shreyas Talpade has a big competition. He just somehow made it for Welcome to Sajjanpur. So my next question is that in the making of the Mahatma, would you like to tell me about the frame you loved or the moment shooting or even otherwise out once the product was ready is your favorite? Like for me, that the railway station scene in the beginning is as beautiful as a painting. Would you like to tell me two things? One is the best frame, what you like, as well as the best moment, either shooting or watching the film later on. Both of you, one after another, sir.
I think we both have the same favorite.
You mentioned being thrown out of the train. I actually have a still photograph of that blown up. And I agree, it's a portrait. It's so beautiful, captured by this woman who was our still photographer. From another person's point of view, for me, eternally and internally, both the point where I, and that shot is there while I'm cutting my hair. It's for real. It's not fake. And then there was a gap of an hour or two where I had to go into the makeup and change, which was to follow. And I think I've probably repeated this many times, but, and when I came up outside, in my white sort of plain stark kurta and mundu down the stairs of that makeup van. There was pin drop silence for a couple of seconds. An entire unit of 200 odd people, absolute silence. I walked in silence. I don't know. Just jab baithna tha agle shot ke liye. I sat down. The bhajan started playing. The camera was on the trolley, and then we just believed that somewhere for those few seconds, maybe the Mahatma came into me.
It was the most, is, you know, a very effervescent person. I've never seen him come out of the vanity van like a normal person. He's always, you know, either, you know, dancing or, you know, calling out to someone or saying some jokes, or he's always making us laugh. That's the kind of person he is. And all of us are waiting outside. We just had to change our costumes, so we were ready poor at all. There was somebody else there. And all of us looked at him, and as Rajit said, it truly happened. There was just, you know, everyone just fell silent. And we all just kept looking at him. He just came down, he walked all the way and went and sat under that tree. And we all just kept looking at him. And even Mr. Benegal, I think he kind of understood what's happening, and he immediately called for the shot. And we all started singing the bhajan. We were looking at Rajit and we kept singing the bhajan. Rajit had tears rolling down his eyes, and which we can't explain.
And it was suddenly became, also it suddenly became slightly cloudy. I just can't explain.
Yeah.
It's like that nature was also part of that entire scenario. The light, the natural light changed for those seconds.
It was also the last shot of the day. So that date kind of just ended on a very different note for all of us.
Yeah, for the second or third time, and first time from Pallaviji. But every time I hear you narrate this, I can see the magic on your faces. It's always magical listening to this moment. That is why I asked this question. One more question I would like to ask, as because, you know, you have other very significant work. Although right now we are talking about this movie, like Rajat ji can easily be, you know, if somebody identifies as a Byomkesh Bakshi, is a very natural thing for Rajat ji. Similarly, Pallaviji, you have done some very significant work, which I liked very much, but is not seen much. It was the Khayal Gatha by Kumar Shahni, a story of the Indian classical music, Khayal. But it is not. Do you think there are
I have done that.
Okay, I think I mixed up with the Mrigneni and that part. Okay,
Mrigneni, right. Yes. Mrigneni. Yes.
Okay, so I mean, do you think more stories of Gandhi that would have been told, like, there, you know, everything cannot be like Gandhi, cannot be contained in a film. Biography of Gandhi is a huge, I mean, great book. So do you think there are more things to be told about Gandhi?
Of course. I mean, it's an entire lifetime that we're talking about, and only a handful of films have been, and theatre productions have been made on his life. So I'm sure there are a lot of other aspects of filmmakers decide to sit down and write a different...
Anything to say, like you said, you went through the his experiments with truth, and anything that you would have really liked to portray, apart from the moment you just described to us, anything else?
The cities that Gandhi went to, and we actually went to those cities. Maybe we forgot to, both of us, add. We went to Pietermaritzburg, we went to Durban, we went to the where the Phoenix settlement was. And maybe that's why it created its own charm of going back in time and trying to create those moments.
Add to your Yashwant question earlier. See, Gandhi now, I think, has ceased being a human being for people, but Gandhi is more of an idea. And hence, that idea is with their own points of view. And make more films on Gandhi, and we all would welcome
him. Something like that.
Yeah. Another thing I'd like Please. To add is, because honestly, you know, it's very easy to criticize somebody. And of course, if we are saying a person is human, then there will be stuff to criticize.
Of course.
But I think you have to also remember that for X, Y, or Z leader, they did what they thought was the right thing at that time. Sometimes if we just create hypothetical questions, would he have done this today? I mean, it's really difficult to say. I mean, how can I say whether he would have done this today? The times are different. True. So these hypothetical questions sometimes are quite unnerving, because they have to remain a hypothesis.
I think I would agree with you. Of course, I personally would say hypothetical. I think we are nearing the end of this. Younger people who are really on work of art. What do you like to tell them?
I would keep it very simple. That here was this great man that you call father. Done a lot. As I said earlier, they were human beings. They must have made some mistakes. But looking at the greater good, I'm sure the mistakes were, you know, the share of mistakes were far, far lesser than the great work that they have done. So try and remember them for the work, for their contribution to our freedom struggle, for their contribution to bring us to where we are today. And especially in today's time of social media, where everybody is like picking on the smallest of mistakes, I would like to basically reach out to the youngsters and say that, you know, we should be very thankful to all the people who have done good for our country. And follow a little bit of Gandhian principles. Leave the evils, you know, get rid of them. Just remember the good things that
Rajat ji, if
Picking up from what Pallavi was saying, I think the canvas is so large, so vast, whether it was a peak. Maybe sab kuch hum apna nahi sakte. Lekin wo treasure house ka jo paimana hai, wo itna bada hai. There is so much that you can learn from, get inspired by. So take what you think appeals to you that would help you in your life. It's not possible for you to apply everything. तो आपको जो सही लगे, आपको जो लगे इनकी जिंदगी में, इनकी फिलॉसफी से जिससे आप प्रेरित होते हैं, तो उसी को अपनाइए. छोटे से छोटा भी आपकी जिंदगी सुधार सकता.
I think that's a very good note to conclude on. I would like to thank you so much for always giving Speakmaker so much time. If you have any quick thoughts to share about any memorable moment at all, we have 3 minutes. Maybe one of you has anything to tell us about, because you've had you in different schools, colleges. If you have anything you would like to share with us, since we have 3 minutes.
You know, it's wonderful that Speakmake is able to bring the arts closer to our children and our students. So, salute you.
So, thank you. And I would like to request Yashwanji also to conclude the session. And for
to see real life Gandhi and Kasturba, and of course it's just a pleasure. And I'm sure that everybody watching will be inspired, and they had an insight. Besides the beautiful what they watched, they had an insight and detail into characters and everything. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
It was a pleasure. And I would just like to say that I've done more online Speakmake events than I've actually, you know, come to Delhi for. So if we can travel again, I would like to come and, you know, meet with all the young people. Hopefully.
That's all. Wonderful. We look forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So, just the formal announcement now. We'll be again reconvening at 2 o'clock. 1 to 2 is for lunch, and I think Charu ma'am, if you would just like to say how we go ahead after to conclude this. Rajat ji, I think thank you for joining us, and if you need, because we committed to you till lunch, so we can let you go now.
All right.
Okay. Thank you, Rajat ji. Thank you. Thanks. So much. I always look forward to listen to that experience when you came down and there was a moment of silence. It gives me so much of goosebumps, but nothing to, you know, this moment when you shared, when I heard you the first time in Delhi, I was like, I couldn't stop tears rolling down my eyes. It was so beautiful. And of course, there's always a different experience when we watch, you know, it's physically when we watch and watching on the, and you did that. So thank you so much for giving us the time. And I think Pallavi ji has left and I couldn't say thanks to her. Prime Minister is inaugurating it formally. Yeah. So if you have the time, please do watch. And I'll keep updating and disturbing you with the schedule. Thank you. All right. Namaste. All right. Bye-bye. Bye.